grandchildren also are here. But yes, my husband is still there, and I've got my other grandchild and son-in-law. Yeah, they will be join us hopefully on Friday, if everything will be okay. Please God, yeah.
Please God. So, what did they do last night?
Hide in the safe room, like everyone, nothing
Like,
else they could do. Yeah.
well, Lauren Boolkin, your son logged in from Israel, and I said to him, "How was last night?" And
He
he
went to
said
sleep.
he went to sleep. Can
Yeah.
you explain that to us?
No, it's, I mean, and also, he messaged me and said, stop watching TV and go to sleep. And they all went to sleep. I feel like we here get so engrossed in it, and there they get on with their lives.
Well, the most downloaded Google term last night was songs. So I imagine that a lot of people were reading to Helen. I was. I didn't
There were
watch
lots of
much.
groups, lots and
I did
lots of
not
groups.
read watch much. I read the 150 chapters of Helen.
My goodness, 150.
Yep.
Okay, quite.
What else can I do except dive
Okay, Dina, how did you?
in? How did I?
Spend last night.
Oh, sure. Last night. That was so long ago, Howard.
Did you stay up to watch the fireworks?
Listen, I stay up anyway, so I'm glued to it regardless. So I landed up watching all, yeah. And you also, you've got to check all the different kind of channels to see the different kinds of coverage. So I sort of switch and toggle between
And
each.
often on Twitter, you find out information before you do, if you follow the right people on Twitter, before it appears on CNN or BBC or Sky.
Exactly. And depending what the headline is.
So I want to know from our participants as we chat towards at over 7 o'clock when we're starting this evening. In the old days, going back pre-COVID, 20, 30, 40 people for Pesach dinner. Lauren Boolkin, does anyone have the energy to do that anymore?
I certainly don't do it anymore. I have toned it down. Fortunately, it's very hard to really build it back up again. Now, I half think I'm going to invite a whole lot of people, and then push comes to shove, and I actually haven't. But I enjoy it with my family. Now, I feel comfortable to sing on top of my voice and wave my arms around and be a frog, and yeah, so it's okay. Okay,
Really, I want to come to your next later.
Okay, deal, done, deal, Dean. My family might come.
Daniel just said, can you please be
Yes,
unmuted?
thank you, thank you. We're following him. We're
All
asking
right.
him
And then Melissa, are there any special
Where are
traditions?
you going, Howard?
Sorry,
Where are you going for Pesach?
I am going to Skukuza,
Ooh.
and
It's going to be one with he's going to be one with the bush, He's got to
Daddy,
feel
Daddy,
the natural
Daddy.
the, and the wild animals and the God
Oh.
knows, I'm not going to say what else
And
can
you,
catch in the
Dina?
game reserve. Now I'm with my family. I am with my family always. Thank God. I actually get a pass because they're amazing. They do the seders, and they just want their grandchildren. I'm like, what can I do? What can I make? I try, and my efforts are often refuted. But it's a very very easy Pesach for me. I should not complain.
Fantastic.
But so
Tastes great.
I have a question because the knedlach has been made frozen, the soup has been made refrozen, the egg in salt water will be made on Friday, and we're leaving on Sunday. Mock crayfish,
Yes.
can I freeze?
No. Cook the
You
fish.
can freeze it without, you can cook the fish, and you can freeze it in chunks, but you have to put the mayonnaise the day of. You
Okay.
can
Lauren, were
freeze
you
the
going to
white
say
fish,
that?
the hake. You could
No, you
boil
don't
and
use
freeze
hake.
it.
You have to use kingfish.
Kinklip. Well, you don't get kinklip in America. So they're lucky for the caballo and kinklip people in South Africa. We have to deal with hake. Okay. And tilapia. Ugh. Yes, but you can freeze it.
I don't know who else even eats mock crayfish. Miriam, do
Oh,
you
I
eat
love
the
my
best
crayfish.
in
This is
avocado?
right. Oh, no.
Yum.
We
Is
love
mock
my
crayfish
crayfish.
even a thing? It is.
Love. We just cook the kinklip. In Israel, we do the fish called amnon. I don't know if they got it here. No, I don't think so. It's like tilapia fish. It's actually very similar to tilapia fish. That's what we cook. And there is that fish that they do, what they call it, the gefilte, you know, that fish, that gefilte from.
Or you can make the fish balls with it, but you would only put the mayonnaise and the grain mixture when you're ready to combine, because the when you thaw it, the water will dilute the sauce. But you
Okay,
can make
thank
them
you.
separately, and you can store the grain and the mayonnaise in a jar.
I'm very concerned that Miriam, who is Moroccan,
Yeah.
is telling us about gefilte fish. Daniel, is it true that Ashkenazim can't cook?
Well, I'm Ashkenaz by creed, and I can cook.
But let's face it, you've tasted Sephardi cooking. Where did our ancestors go wrong? Where did they lose their sense of taste when they landed up in Europe, when they could have landed up in North Africa? Dad?
Well, food in general is very much tied to region. And if you look at any cuisine, it's all about what those people were able to obtain where they were living. And I think our ancestors in Eastern Europe were limited with what they had access to. And granted, I think they did a pretty good job with what they had access to. I mean, obviously they didn't have access to such nice spices and things that Sephardi people had access to in North Africa and in the more western part of Europe. Whereas in the eastern part of Europe, food was a commodity. It was tough.
So,
Also, I think
Juliet, I want
gefilte and
I we
gefilte.
haven't heard from Juliet. I want to hear from Juliet. So your Seder, is it traditional? Is it egg in salt water? Is it knedlach soup? Is it chopped herring and gefilte fish? Tell us what you're making
Totally.
the
Totally everything we love, all the traditional food. And I made it my mission to make it the most tasty traditional food that you actually can get. So people come to my house and they say they've never eaten chopped liver like this, they've never eaten the fish like this, because I believe with this type of food and the Ashkenazi Eastern food can be unbelievably tasty.
So I want to tell you, for Jewish Achiever Awards in 2023, Dina thought I was completely and utterly insane. But we said to Dolores, our
Still do.
caterer, we said to Dolores, our caterer, we are going to reinvent what traditional Jewish food looks like in the 21st century. And so this is what we served. Gefilte fish, a piece in a grain-flavored macaron.
Wow.
We had
It was a twist
we had a chicken soup with a knedel flavored breadstick.
Wow.
We had
Which is reasonable.
a kichel cup with a mustard herring inside. So you bit into the entire cup when you ate the herring. We had a blintzer served with borscht beetroot soup.
Oh.
Dina, I'm leaving out one or two things. Do you remember what else we served?
Yes, that's the main.
So we served a blintzer with like a mushroom, sort of like a cooked mushroom inside of it. And
Oh, and
then
my
we served a
favorite,
smoked
my
salmon with a poppy seed. How do you forget
no.
that?
So
What
this
about
was
the ice cream?
by far the favorite. We served smoked salmon on an ice cream that was flavored with lemon rind and black pepper.
Wow.
And
Wow.
the reviews we got from this absolutely blew people away.
Well, Dolores can cook. Let's just
Dolores
establish.
can
Dolores
cook.
can
It
cook.
just takes a little of imagination of what
Wow.
it means to
Thanks for
reinvent
the
what, you know, tickets are available. You could have purchased it. All money raised goes to charity, goes to support the free publication and distribution of the Jewish Report newspaper. So
one of your events.
get on an aeroplane and come We also, the first course after the amuse-bouche, we had a Thai fish served in a Thai broth. And and then our next thing we had beef, lamb, and chicken all done in various different ways, including chicken in a apricot jam. We had phyllo pastry. We did lamb baklava. And for dessert, we served a box with six desserts in that if you weren't hungry, you could take all six desserts home in the box.
Absolutely astounding. How did you think this all up?
I need pictures. I need someone to send me pictures of this, please.
So it was many, many, many rounds for Dolores. She has the patience of a saint.
Dolores tells me that every time I walk into her office, she absolutely dreads it and it's the worst day of the year.
I doubt that.
So the time has just gone 7 p.m. South Africa time on what's starting to feel like a slightly winterish evening. And a big welcome to everyone around the world who's watching us this evening, on watching us on Zoom, on YouTube, on Facebook, and hopefully it's working that we're watching live as well on Instagram. So a big welcome to everyone this evening. Dina, I wasn't around for our last webinar. The last webinar you hosted together with Howard Feldman, and we had Douglas Murray on that webinar, and we've been watched well in excess of 600,000 times on YouTube from that webinar. How was it?
So let me tell you, I think Douglas exceeded all of our expectations. I think he was absolutely, absolutely outstanding. I mean, first of all, he's consistent. He's bright. He's personable. There's absolutely nothing negative that you can say about Douglas. I'm sorry, my child is in the background. But I mean, it was just a phenomenal, phenomenal event. He really brought the community in. We could only get a certain amount of people in the actual hall, but I'm telling you now, if we could have had a hall for 5,000 people or more, we would have filled it, because that is the attraction he has, the way he speaks, his eloquence. Howard Feldman did a great job. He discussed South Africa. He obviously discussed all the issues in Israel. He discussed his thoughts, his views. And I have to say, I think he blew everyone away. Everyone.
Well, certainly 600,000 people watching. The only thing we've done that's had a bigger audience than that was bizarrely our webinar, which touched on ivermectin, which someone then stole, reposted, and got more than 1 million views. But we've now been watched well in excess of 5 million times since we started our webinar series. So it's absolutely remarkable and incredible. And of course, these webinars are brought to you courtesy of the South African Jewish Report. And we are on webinar, 166, Dina, is that correct?
166. I actually can't believe it. In fact, when I think about how many Pesach webinars alone that we've done, you know what they say, Dayenu.
Well, do you remember our first Pesach webinar during COVID, when in fact we started getting messages from people during the webinar to saying, I'm in London, I'm in lockdown, I can't get hold of matzah, I can't get Pesach stick food. We got messages from people in Australia telling us the exact same thing. They can't get hold of Pesach stick food. And what we did is we said to everyone watching, if you're stuck at home, if you're isolated, if you can't get matzah, if you can't get wine, if you can't get kosher Pesach food, let us know and we'll take care of it. And everyone on the board of the Jewish Report called up their friends in New York and San Francisco and Sydney and Melbourne and London, and we delivered food right around the world to people who are stuck at home, unable to go get during the dark, dark days of COVID. So it's something that we're enormously proud of, and just kind of the sort of thing that the Jewish Report has done for our community and the Jewish community around the world. And our webinars have become an international sensation, watched all around the world, not just live in the evening, but on YouTube for weeks and weeks to come. People will watch. But we've got Pesach looming tomorrow, a week. So Dina, tell us what's in store this evening.
All right. So I am so excited. So the wonderful thing that happens every single time we try and do a Pesach webinar is we think, well, where else can we go? Who else can we speak to? Who have we seen? Who haven't? So we like to bring some old favorites back, but we always like to mix it up and add a few new, a bit of new blood. So, and luckily we've got both as a perfect mix on this webinar. So, I mean, so we've got Melissa back all the way from LA. Always great to have her. I mean, sometimes she's in Italy, sometimes she's in LA. We don't always know where we're going to catch her, but a ball of energy and a ball of excitement, which we love. We've got Lauren Boolkin, who is just like our staple. Like, we know she's reliable, she's dependable, and she's unbelievable every single time. Every recipe she has and everyone that I've tried has been always delicious. And she's always got some little tricks and machines that she uses. So she keeps it interesting. So we love that about Lauren. And then we have Miriam, who's here all the way from Israel to come cook for us. And she's cooked for you. And I told you I've tasted what she's making today. And I would never even have thought to make it, but when you see it, you'll see, oh wow, obviously we should make that. But it was delicious. And then we also thought, you know what, within our community there are people that we don't know about, people that we always know who we know, but what about the other people that we aren't aware of who cook and can contribute and who would be amazing? So I put a call out on JJM, Joburg Jewish Mummies, and I got a slew of names and opportunities that we could look at. And so we could only fit in two. So we've got obviously more potential for future. But one of them is Juliet Sack. Juliet's mom is the famous Sandy Williams. So Juliet, you've grown up in a home with culinary mastery. So it's in your blood. And she now runs a cooking school. So we'll hear all about that. And then Chef Dan also is highly, highly recommended. And he's got really, really cool recipe up his sleeve. So I think everyone's going to really enjoy that. We've got a mix of the traditional and a spin on the traditional. So I think that everyone is going to be absolutely mouthwateringly like famished by the end of this. But hopefully we'll give you some new ideas, new recipes, and some of the good oldies. And I think that'll be really great for your Pesach, for your Seder, and for hopefully the whole week. So I can't wait to see all of it.
So just before we begin, just a reminder to everyone that the latest edition of the South African Jewish Report is out and about, and you can go collect your copy at your local Spar, your local Checkers, Pick and Pay, Dischem, your kosher butchery, at the schools around the place. We distribute
Kosher World, of course.
Kosher World. Yes. We distribute in about 220 locations around the place. Dylan, we'd love to know what's on the front cover of this week's Jewish Report, and also next week's Jewish Report, our Pesach edition, will be out on Tuesday. So, Dylan, if you can show us the front page of the Jewish Report, it's the fact that, for example, I see Paul Kagame met with the Israeli president, Budi Herzog. And the other thing is that some of the Israel haters are calling for probes into Jewish organizations. Well, all I can say is they're welcome. Come probe us. Be like an alien. We like being probed. So the latest edition of the Jewish Report is out. Please go collect a copy. If you can't pick up a hard copy, or if we run out of our Pesach edition, which is coming out this coming week, you can always go on to www.sajr.co.za, where you can either read the individual articles, or alternatively, you can go and click and download the entire edition as well. And the latest edition of the Jewish Report, the Pesach edition, will be out and available to everyone on Wednesday evening and distributed in hard copy on Thursday. So Dylan, tell us as well where we can find our webinars. Well, our webinars, you can either go onto our website, click on webinars. All our last webinars are actually there. Or alternatively, you can go onto our YouTube channel and just look for the SA Jewish Report on YouTube. Click under live, click under webinars. You'll find all of our past webinars of the 166 webinars. I think at least 155 are there. So you can go and catch up on anything that you've missed. And we're enormously excited about our next webinar. Our next webinar after this is going to be on the 5th of May. And our next webinar is going to be with the hostage negotiator. Gershon Baskin goes to a conference in Turkey. This is going back to 2011. And he meets a group of Hamas people in Turkey. He goes back to Israel a few weeks later. Hamas breaks into Israel, kidnaps Gilad Shalit, an Israeli soldier, and holds him hostage in Gaza. One of the first big hostage cases of the modern era. And Gershon Baskin picks up the phone to the people that he just met in Turkey, and he says to them, let's start negotiating for Gilad Shalit's release. It took 5.5 years of negotiations, but Gilad Shalit was finally released. But was it the right thing or the wrong thing? Because one of the people that they released as part of the slew of hundreds and hundreds of Palestinian prisoners they released in return for Gilad Shalit, one of the people they released was Yahya Sinwar. And so we've got a very interesting discussion with Gershon Baskin, the person who started the negotiations for Gilad Shalit. And we've got him to tell his story on the 5th of May, as well as some really difficult questions about the current hostages and was it worth the price that was paid for Gilad Shalit. We'll see you all on Sunday, the 5th of May at 7 p.m. in order to discuss all of that. So with that, don't forget, if you want to ask any of our chefs any questions, if you're watching on Zoom, either pop a question into the chat section or into the Q&A section, we'll monitor that. Or alternatively, Dylan and Britt will be monitoring you on YouTube, on Facebook, and on Instagram. So if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to post into the chat sections there, and they'll make sure that they bring all your questions and comments through so our remarkable team of chefs can, in fact, do that as well. And Dina, just a surprise for people coming up. We're going to give away a lot of prizes tonight. What prizes are we giving away tonight?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I am actually, I'm trying to just sort my video and take away my blur. In my background, you should be able to see, we have got one massive Iger air fryer. Listen, air fryers are definitely the new black. Let me explain. If you do not have an air fryer, you need an air fryer. And this Iger one, let me explain. It has 5 versatile cooking functions, non-stick surface, adjustable temperature, touchscreen control, 8-liter capacity, which means it can put an entire chicken in it, which I have done, and it's outstanding. And it's got slimline space, and it actually looks very cool on your counter. That is an unbelievable prize. And then we
so, Dina, very important Iger. About air fryers. We checked last year. You cannot Pesach deck an air fryer. So if you want to use your air fryer this Passover, you need a new air fryer. And you've got a chance to win one tonight.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's an awesome one. So, yeah. So that is a very, very exciting prize that we have donated by SMD Technologies and coincidentally linked to Miriam. But we have it's an amazing, amazing brand, amazing, amazing prize. And then we also have 2 awesome Iger toasters. So those are also at your big retail stores, but really, really great prizes. And I think anyone tonight is on actually to get a prize, and we'll put the polls up and you'll see how you win those prizes. And we've also, so in addition to those, we have lots and lots of wine to give away, because Pesach is the time to drink your 4 cups of wine and potentially more. So we've got rosé, we've got chardonnay, we've got Pinot Noir, anything that you probably desire, we have. So all of those will be given away tonight. And again, they'll be part of the polls, but you'll see those details that are coming up.
Fantastic. Well, Dina, let's talk about some food. I'm starving.
Marvelous. So there is a wonderful TikToker / Instagrammer named Sivan, and she calls herself Sivan's Kitchen. So she has provided us with a very quick video. It's a 1.5, obviously, because the world of TikTok and that generation there, I think the attention span is only 1.5 minutes. So everything's in bite-sized chunks. And this is a bite-sized chunk for Pesach. So Dylan's just going to quickly play this. And it's a little tidbit on what we can look at. It's more desserty, sweet.
As promised, I'm officially kicking off my Passover.
Let's see, we're just going to get to it, and here we go.
As promised, I'm officially kicking off my Passover recipes, starting off with this tasty and easy-to-make matzah crack. The first part of this recipe is to make your homemade caramel. You may be pleasantly surprised to know that making homemade caramel is very simple, especially if you use this foolproof 3-ingredient recipe. And this recipe happens to be parve, but you can make it dairy if you wish. All right, now it's time to assemble. On a baking sheet lined with parchment paper, place your matzah squares. Some may need to be broken, but don't worry about that. Pour over your beautiful caramel and smooth it out, covering all your matzah pieces. Bake it for a short 7 minutes till it gets nice and bubbly. Top it off with some chocolate chunks, and as they're melting, you're gonna smooth it out, making sure to cover the entire surface. Now from this point on, you can get as creative as you like and use any toppings of your choice. I added white chocolate chips, shredded coconut, and crushed pistachios, but make sure not to miss that flaky salt. Once you're done, you're gonna place it in your fridge for a few hours to harden, and then, so satisfying. This is guaranteed one of the best Passover desserts. Everyone will love this and will be asking for more. Can be made ahead of time and frozen. Or better yet, how about make it, place it in a signature cake box, and bring it as a hostess gift? But for now, I'll be here, dunking my matzah crack and enjoying my afternoon coffee. Happy baking.
So admit, that's an innovative way. So we actually started with desserts. You know, they say start with desserts.
Okay, so I've never heard of matzah crack before. Are you going to be sending out all the recipes, Dina?
Absolutely. I always get asked that question. And we are most certainly going to send out all of the recipes. So stay tuned.
Okay. So tell us who our first chef is we're going to be meeting.
All right, before we start with our first chef, we're going to go into our first ad because we've got amazing sponsors. And as you know, Kosher World, I'm so sorry. That's what happens when you have a two-year-old, guys. That's why you need Kosher World, because without Kosher World, you wouldn't be able to get all the things you need to manage your life and your Pesach. So Kosher World are one of our amazing sponsors. They keep coming back. And what's amazing is you walk in there, you don't have to guess. You know exactly what's kosher for Pesach. You know exactly what's kosher. So without further ado, let's run their ad.
Just to add, sorry, I was there today and it was fantastic. I managed to get everything I needed. And I feel a little bit less stressed going into the week for Pesach. So good job, Kosher World.
Dina, I love the fact that Amy tells us that matzah bark sounds much better than matzah crack. Although I don't know. It looks very addictive.
Listen, you
want
it to be
so
maybe, I don't know what you're saying.
Maybe crack is the right thing.
Absolutely. So moving on quickly from that, but it does look like a very interesting recipe and I actually think I would make it. Let's start with Melissa Mayo, all the way in LA because she's been patient. It's 10 o'clock. She's got to go to the beach. So we're going to start with her. She's got amazing recipes. Melissa, how are you doing?
Hi, gorgeous. I wish I could say it was the beach day. It's a little bit misty and overcast, but the rain is always a blessing for Eretz Israel.
Great. So tell us, what are you going to be making? So you're giving us recipes, which are your classics, but everyone can make. Tell us about them.
So we're going to be watching two videos, but I want you, when you watch these two videos, to have a very open mind, because I always like to teach people to cook without recipes. Now, despite the fact I don't love brisket, my brisket recipes have been downloaded over a million times. Today, I'm sharing with you my Nando's Peri Peri brisket. But once you've watched that video, we're going to come back and discuss how all brisket needs to be done, sliced, cut, and the 101 of how to rock out an epic brisket. And there are, as I say, 3, 4, 5 brisket recipes on my website. I'm also going to be, they're going to be airing a roasted vegetable video. But then we're going to come back in here and I'm really going to give you the 101 of vegetable roasting based roots vegetables versus water-based vegetables that you can cook whatever you have in your fridge, no mess, no fuss, and know how to substitute dry to wet or fresh herbs. So it's really an intro into the recipes, but I'm then going to show you how to improvise.
Marvelous. All right. So Dylan, let's rock and roll with the videos.
How's it? I'm Melissa Mayo, and today I'm using my favorite hot sauce on the planet, Nando's Peri Peri, all the way from South Africa to rock out an amazing and epic brisket.
In a mortar and pestle, combine the salt, black pepper, mustard, cumin, and coriander seeds. Crush the spices well to form a dry rub. Generously season the brisket on both sides with the rub. In a bowl, combine the fig jam, red wine vinegar, Worcester sauce, our super secret ingredient, Nando's Piri Piri, hot water, stock powder, and bay leaves. Whisk these together to form a sauce. Slice the onions, celery, garlic, and a trio of peppers. Heat some olive oil in a heavy pan over high heat. Sear the brisket on all sides to seal in the juices. When it is nicely browned, set it aside. In the same pan, add some olive oil and cook the onions, celery, peppers, and garlic on medium heat until softened and caramelized. Place the brisket on top of the veggies and pour over the sauce. Cover the brisket tightly with a lid or parchment paper to create a steam bath. Bake for 2.5 to 3 hours, turning midway.
So I pulled this beauty out of the oven, and the way I know that it's ready is that it's knife tender, which means I can put a knife in and out of it and it comes out without much resistance. What you want to do when you cook meat is always remove it and tent it while it is cooling. That allows the juices to redistribute. And so we're going to let the brisket hang out on a baking sheet and let it cool. You can let it cool overnight in the fridge as well before cutting it. If you look at the sauce, it's a little liquidy, so we're going to put it on the stovetop now and let it reduce till it's soupy.
Once the meat is completely cold, use a sharp knife to cut thick slices against the grain. Place the meat in a baking dish. Pour over the thickened sauce and garnish with some fresh chives.
So by far the hardest part of today has been waiting for the brisket to cook. And now is my favorite part of cooking, tasting. So I'm going to grab a piece of this yummy, succulent meat and some of the peppers and onions and veggies and sweet potato, and I'm going to give it a real taste test. I know that was a big bite, but I have been waiting all day for it, and guess what? It did not disappoint. It's moist, it's succulent, it's juicy, it's got that kick of peri peri, and you will not be sorry that you risked it on my brisket.
So Melissa, I have two questions. Is that normal brisket or is that pickled brisket to start off with? That's question number one. And question number two, I'm not sure in South Africa if Nando's Piri Piri sauce is Pesach Dik this year. So what can we substitute if we can't get Pesach Dik Nando's?
So let's talk through that. First off, that is not a pickled brisket. It is the first cut of brisket. So rule 101 when ordering your brisket, you need to order the first cut of brisket. Now, ignoring my recipe, ignoring it because I'm going to teach you how to cook. There are a couple of recipes on my website. The trick on brisket is obviously you'd never want to start meat unless it's room temperature. So you're going to season it. There's a balsamic mushroom glazed cranberry brisket on my website. There's a thermos brisket. You're going to want to put it on a pan like this, a griddle pan on the oven. And you are going to want, when it's room temperature with its salt and pepper and spices, to totally seal in the juices, which some people skip. So that is part one. Part two is that you're then going to create your liquid. Now, your liquid can have a vinegar. I'm sure there's some sort of, I don't know if the Nando's Piri Piri is kosher for Passover. I'm sure there's a hot sauce, but if not, you know, that you could use wine, liquid. You're just creating a decent amount of liquid with enough aromatics. For example, my cranberry mushroom balsamic glaze griset has celery, onions, mushrooms, and then it has a red wine and a balsamic glaze to it with some fig jam. And that is like a sweet and sour brisket and a lot of fresh herbs. The second thing would then be creating your liquid bath, same steps. Then you're going to sear your veggies in a heavy Dutch oven. If you do not have one, but you need to paint this well and with parchment paper before putting it into the oven and cooking it. Now, people think that the brisket is undercooked, but remember, we're going to slice the brisket and we're going to cook it back in the sauce the following day. So what I would encourage you is you take out the brisket, you let it cool in the refrigerator. It is much easier to cut when it's cold. Your first knee-jerk reaction when you pull it out of the fridge is going to be, oh my God, it's hot. It's hard, so you can cut it well. That's the most important thing. You cut it across the grain, you put it in its dish, and if this was the point that you needed to freeze your brisket, this is when you would freeze your brisket. So that the last part of marrying the sauce with the brisket is done in the oven at the time of cooking it. But the whole trick is to seal in the juices and to let it actually marry in the sauces. And the veggies, you can be creative. In the one that I've just shared, it has a trio of peppers, so it has more of a Mexican, African feel. My balsamic glazed brisket has more of an Italian feel. I don't love sweet, sweet briskets, but if you were to apply the same principles with your prunes and your apricots, you'd have Simmers brisket. But searing the brisket, covering it with liquid once you've browned the veggies, cutting it cold, and then putting it away and heating it through when you're ready to serve it.
So give us some ideas, because Nando's is probably out for us. Mustard can't use over Pesach. Give us some other ideas of what we can use as a sauce.
Could you do some chili? Just throwing that out there.
You could use sweet chili, but I was not able to film myself today, hence the use of a video. But my most downloaded recipe is actually a balsamic cranberry glazed brisket. I will send you, Dina, the recipe as well, so you have that brisket. So that would start off with searing the brisket in salt and pepper. And then the mix is made up of balsamic vinegar, red wine, aromatics, and it's almost like, I'm going blank on the word, it's an Italian dish, which is very, very savory. And then I would saute some celery, onions, and mushrooms would be my veggies, and it would go over the top. Same principles, exactly the same way you wrapped out the brisket, and then the sweetness of the fig jam would combine with the balsamic glaze and create the sweet and sour brisket that is just to die for, really, to die for.
Balsamic vinegar and...
Exactly. And so you could probably substitute out the Nando's peri-peri in the recipe that I just gave you to include just balsamic or red wine against the jam. And you would just leave out the seeds. You would just do salt and pepper on the brisket if you wanted to have some heat. I'm sure there must be some sort of hot sauce that is kosher for Passover, because I think there must be a chili available. And funnily enough, the actual jam of this brisket doesn't make it hot that the kids can't eat it. It's not hot enough that it's almost like a sweet and spicy, but still sweet enough that the young kids will enjoy it. It's not too hot. It's a delicious African spin on brisket.
Delish. So how are you going to take that to the game reserve now?
May very well, but let's look at the veggies, because the veggies I think are very important.
Okay, veggies first.
Hi, I'm Melissa Mayo, and today I'm making Thanksgiving roasted vegetables. I'm using rosemary to spice them, and it's my all-time favorite herb. It makes me happy when it's cooking, but you can serve these vegetables year-round.
In a bowl, combine the chunks of red onion, butternut, baby potatoes, sweet potatoes, yellow squash, zucchini, celery, and carrots. Drizzle with olive oil and sprinkle with fresh chopped rosemary and garlic, whole grain mustard, brown sugar, balsamic vinegar, salt, and pepper. Toss the veggies well to coat them with the oil and spices. Lay them on two Teflon-lined baking sheets, making sure they aren't overcrowded. The trick is that by keeping them one layer thick, they can brown nicely. Roast them in the oven, shaking occasionally till they are golden and caramelized.
So the veggies have caramelized and roasted, and they're beautiful and browned. All the sugars come to the surface. If you could only smell my kitchen, the rosemary is incredible. And I'm just going to transfer them to my serving platter. The sugars have caramelized and the vegetables are simply brilliant. You're going to be falling for these full vegetables again and again.
And for okay. All it is for us as well. So it's the perfect vegetable.
All it is for you too. So let me give you my, and I always like to say this, I believe that everyone is a chef, a master chef, and everyone can cook without a recipe. So my 101 for vegetable roasting is to make sure that your vegetables are equal size and one layer thick. So for example, here, I've cut some roasted root vegetables. So you've got your sweet potatoes, you've got your potatoes, you've got your carrots, you've got your onions, you've got these root vegetables. Now, root vegetables are less water dense. This is your butternut squash. They don't create as much water when they cook in the oven. So they cook at a different rate to what would be your water-based veggies, which are kind of your Italian veggies. So here I've got, you know, my eggplant and my zucchini and my squash and my peppers and my tomatoes and my onions and actually even my mushrooms and but this is all like wet-based veggies. Now, in the recipe you saw that I shared, there was a combination of some of the squashes with some of the root vegetables. But I wanted to show you how easy it is to break them apart. For example, if you were serving your brisket, and you needed like a hearty base, like potatoes or sweet potatoes and something like that that could stand up to a brisket or a chicken, something that could be really, really meaty and hearty, these could be your vegetables. And this is the point at which you become your own chef. You could decide that you would like these to have the taste of like a sweet pumpkin pie. And because the vegetable caramelizes and all the juices come to the surface, you don't need to really add any extra sugar. These are like literally spoonfuls of sugar. So if I were to add cinnamon and nutmeg and ginger and cardamom and star anise and allspice and those kind of warm baking nutmeg spices to this, when this roasted up, it would have that sweet, briskety, like simmersy feel. But if I wanted to, I could give them a very Italian feel and I could put herbs like rosemary and dill and thyme and sage and basil. What I do want to let you know is if you're using fresh herbs, the ratio of a recipe would be twice the amount of fresh herbs to what it would be to be dry herbs. So usually if a recipe called for like, and I'm a generous seasoner, I like to use bold, big spices. So if you were going to use like herb de Provence, a tablespoon of this, you'd be wanting to use 2 or 3 tablespoons of fresh chopped rosemary or dill or thyme. But I'm kind of getting you to just understand that you want vegetables to be one layer thick. So I'm going to explain that in my next thing. And then depending on what you're serving them with, if let's say, for example, you wanted to serve these root veggies with some salmon or some chicken, you'd have them chunkier. But let's say because quinoa is kosher for Pesach, right? Couscous is not. Quinoa is kosher for Pesach. If you wanted to, you could cut these a little bit smaller. And when these were roasted up, they would be a delicious roasted veggies. Let me show you a size I would cut them to. So I would roast them a little bit smaller if I were going to make like a quinoa salad with them. So the chop on it would be smaller when I roasted them. And then I could toss them with something like a red quinoa and have this delicious, hearty, beautiful salad. And again, these veggies, you know, you've got your olive oil, you've got your rosemary, you've got your thyme, all of your spices. But here's the thing. Here's the baking sheet. This is the 101 of vegetable roasting. I've cut them. Let's say I've added all my spices and herbs to the bowl. I like this of being able to come into the bowl and toss them. But look what happens if I put them on a baking sheet. Look how high that is. And this is what I want to teach you. If I were to put that in the oven, I'm going to have soupy, uncolored, very, very, very bland, mushy vegetables. The way to get the brown, golden, caramelized color, and that applies whether I'm cooking root vegetables or I'm cooking a water-based vegetable like this, is to have them one layer thick. So again, I cannot give you an exact recipe because you could be having six people at your Pesach Seder, or you could be having 60. And depending on how many people you're having will depend on how many vegetables you're going to roast. I'm going to a friend and I'm making roast vegetables. And I can guarantee you that I will have probably 10 to 12 trays going at a time. So you see one layer thick. So this is the point at which you will then break your veggies out onto plates that they're one layer thick, remembering to leave enough space around each of them, believe it or not, to get the color. So you should see the parchment paper underneath the baking sheet, because it has that space around the veggies that allows the oven to give it color. I like to cook high, 450, go in once, give it a shuffle and a shake, and that's it, done. Parchment paper is also super, super amazing in that you can pick the ones up once they're done, transfer them into your bowl, and you're good to go. So hopefully with these basics, you can now just become your own chef this Pesach and stop stressing about the recipes and focus more on what you can find in season, what looks great, and what you want to put on the table. And remember, the same rule applies across all vegetable roasting, and you can take it to Italy, Spain, Japan, or you can make it super delicious and desserty so it tastes like pumpkin pie.
So we've got questions coming up.
Great question. How long do you bake the veggies for?
Yes, both Michelle and Belinda wanted to know how long, and don't forget to tell us on what temperature.
Okay.
Exactly.
And Howard, you're going to hate me. Here again is my my kind of
depends.
Chef kind of feel to cooking. So I like to cook things fast and furious because I'm in the kitchen for a certain amount of time. So I put the ovens to 450, okay? And I put all the ovens to 450. But even if the oven was 450, if I were to put in one baking sheet at 450, it is going to cook very differently to three baking sheets at 450, okay? If I kept the oven at 375 and I put one baking sheet, it's going to cook very differently to if I put it in at, you know, three baking sheets.
Okay, I need to translate into South African.
So that's Fahrenheit
is 340 degrees centigrade.
So 200 or like 150.
220.
Okay. Highest temperature versus the lowest temperature.
200. I'd say the range is 150 to 200, like on a normal.
Okay. So if I were going to go in with like three of these baking sheets at the whatever, it would be like 250 for you.
200.
Fast and furious. My advice is it all depends on your oven. I've cooked with Vikings, GE's, Bosch, Wolf. No two ovens are the same. So you're going to put it in. I like to cook it high. I like to shake it midway. And when do you take them out? When they're brown and golden and caramelized. How do you know they're delicious? Because you take them, like my late mother used to say, and you taste it. Is the potato raw? The potato goes back in. Your taste buds are meant to guide you on this. Because if you're having five people for Pesach or you're cooking for 50, you have a very different amount of vegetables that you have to cook with. So fast and furious out on the oven, shaking all the way, and taste being your guide. You'll know what it needs and taste on seasoning. Like at the end, the vegetables don't have enough salt and pepper. And then the most important thing, before serving everything on your Pesach table, a very generous glug, 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 glug of the best Italian olive oil over everything that you can possibly drizzle it, because this is the finishing sauce that is the gold that brings the dish home. Did that answer you, Howard?
It does. It still tells us it depends on size, but apparently I've heard before that size doesn't count.
That's true.
It depends on the vegetable, Howard.
And very importantly, someone who's anonymous but asked the question, if you don't want to use balsamic vinegar, what can you use on your vegetables? Now, balsamic, of course, is fantastic because balsamic contains caramel inside. That's what makes balsamic. So what can you use instead of balsamic?
So if your balsamic has caramel in it, you don't have a good quality balsamic. It shouldn't have caramel in it. So no, then you didn't buy the good balsamic, which will always
have a real Italian one.
It'll always have the blue and yellow Moderna label on it. But if you don't have balsamic, then you're not obviously adding like acid to your vegetables. But if you wanted that balance of acid to whatever,
can you put lemon juice on?
Can replace apple cider vinegar, can replace a lemon, can replace any sort of, understand that all acids are acids. A squeeze of lemon will do the same if you're wanting to add some acidity to the dish. You might just want to be keeping it totally sweet and delicious because you've got a yummy tzimmis prepared and you want it to be like all baking spicy. There would be no vinegar in the mix at all if those were the direction you were taking your vegetables. But vegetables are like a sponge. They will absorb whatever you throw at them, whether you're throwing at them this, or let's see if I can actually flip this into my spice drawer without making it all crazy, or you're using dry spices. It's really that the spices are like the medicine cabinet of the kitchen, and you play with them based on what you're trying to create. And that's what I'm hoping to give you, is a guide to be your own chef this Pesach. It's the love and the amore, which is the most secret ingredient that you can put into the food you're serving this Pesach, which will nourish those people you're sharing it with. The amore is the secret ingredient. Everything else is just logistics.
And of course, we learned from Estelle that size does count, but that's for another webinar. And also, Aubrey says, Mel, you're amazing. Love your recipes. Have a meaningful, good Pesach. Take care. Lots of love, Barbara. And that's from Bernice Burson's mom.
And I also wanted to say that on my website, if you were to go to melissamayo.com recipes, you can search my category. You can just put in brisket. It'll pull up all my brisket. It'll pull up all my veggies. There are over 450 free, delicious, easy recipes. But you can do it without a recipe. I believe in you.
Fantastic.
Again, all your details will be put in the chat as well.
Last question. Brisket, you showed us earlier, can be very stringy. Is cutting across the grain the way to make it less stringy and less stuck in your teeth?
The trick is to get the first cut of brisket, first and foremost, and definitely to cut it across the grain, 1,000%. So and to cut it cold, Too many people make the mistake of cutting the brisket when it's warm, and that's when it kind of shreds into itself, which is great if you're making like carne asada and stuff like that and you want a kind of stringy thing. But actually putting the brisket when it is cooked into the fridge, in letting it cool and cutting it when it's freezing cold. I know your first thought is going to be, oh my God, the brisket is hard. But remember, I said to you, you put your fork or your knife into the brisket. If the brisket goes in and out, the knife goes in and out quickly, and you can, without much resistance, the brisket is done. And remember, once you've now cut it, sliced it, and it's frozen, you're going to put it back in the sauce, and you're going to probably cook it. And with the way the Pesach Seder goes on with the next cup of wine, and then chances are that brisket's going to have so much time to finish its cooking life during the Pesach Seder. Do not panic when it's hard. That is the best time to cut your brisket. Do not panic when it is rock hard. Okay.
Mel, go to the beach. Go to the beach. Thank you. That sounds delicious. I'm starving already.
All right.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Why? I'm muted, Mel. I'm sorry. I muted you. Forgive me.
But enjoy the beach. Have a wonderful time. All right. Now, yes, our mouths are watering. So I think before we go into our next one, Mantis have been with us through all our webinars since the beginning of COVID. They even, in fact, we specifically asked if we could use the one that we originally used to take us back to the days of COVID to show us what they did, how they did it, all the amazing work that Mantis did. So let us roll the Mantis ad and then obviously as our sponsor, and then we'll be back with you shortly. There we go. Thank you, Mantis.
And Dina, just to remind everyone, all the recipes tonight will be sent to everyone who registered as well.
Absolutely, because we get requests and requests, so we make sure that we do cover that one. Don't you worry. So, Howard, as we know, obviously, we've been going through our webinars. We have always run polls, and tonight is no different. And except the difference is tonight, we have unbelievable prizes. We have air fryers. We have toasters from Iger. Really, really unbelievable appliances. We have loads of wine because we love to give back to the people who watch us. We love to engage with them and we give them value. So we are going to run a quick poll now. And if we can put up the poll so we can discuss it. So obviously also all of us do this, as we have previously mentioned, out of our sense of community service and our commitment to the community. The South African Jewish Report has a team of extremely dedicated, unbelievable people that have managed to hold people together through COVID. And we have managed even through COVID to get through some of it with the donations from all of you. So as we carry on with this, the option for the poll, donate with entry option. I would like to donate to the South African Jewish Report and stand a chance of winning a prize. Please send me donation details. One entry into the draw, 180 Rand. Three entries into the draw, 360 Rand. Five entries into the draw, 540. Nine entries, 900. 10 entries, 1800. Or another amount. Any amount that you guys give us, help us do the work that we do, help us pay the professional staff, and help us create this quality newspaper, quality publication, and now obviously media channel that we bring to you all of the time. So please feel free. We're going to leave the poll up for a few minutes.
And Dina, just to remind people what they can win. So you've got lots and lots of wine you're giving away. You've got an egg fryer, not an egg fryer, an air fryer.
You can fry an egg in an air fryer.
You've got toasters that you're giving away. And just so people who are watching us know, of course, we've got editors and journalists and people who we need to print and distribute the Jewish Report. None of that happens for free. Ultimately, someone has to pay. Dina and myself, we are volunteers in this organization. We have no benefit. We give of our time and our energy to make sure that you have the ability not just to read the Jewish Report free of charge every week, both online and in person, but as well to now have seen 166 different webinars, to attend events like the Jewish Achiever Awards, to attend events like Douglas Murray as well. All of that takes money. And while our volunteers can do whatever we can, it costs money to have a hall for Douglas Murray. It costs money for cameramen to be able to broadcast. It costs money for us to bring the internet in to be able to broadcast the Douglas Murray event. It costs us Zoom licensing fees. Printing alone per edition, printing and distribution is about 100,000 Rand per edition, or more than 100,000 Rand per edition we put out. And we put out, what, 45 editions a year. All of that costs. So we would love you to join the family and join with us and be part of the Jewish Report family so we can continue to deliver these remarkable services to our community. But it really does need your help. So if you're able to, please give generously.
Absolutely. Now getting back to the cooking. All right. So those prizes again, up for grabs, and we'll announce them within the next week and in the Jewish Report on our upcoming edition. But Lauren Boolkin, so great to see you again. You are always ready to cook. It's your total passion.
And so ready to eat.
And what are you going to be making for us tonight?
So I'm doing the traditional soup and canela, because I just feel that we need to get back to what our babas made and back to the Lithuanian recipes that we were talking about, and the mock crayfish and the simmers and the gefilte fish. And I just think that if we don't preserve those recipes, they're not going to be around in 20, 30 years' time.
Absolutely. So Lauren, and as we've
I have important questions. Some people's knedlach are light and fluffy. Some people's knedlach are harder, but maybe more tasteful. What is it that creates knedlach to either be hard or soft?
My mother used to do it and touch it and feel it. And she used to go, this is perfect. I can't do that. I do exact quantities that I got from my very good friend. The recipe that I do on my video will never, never flop. Whoever I've given it to has come back with the most perfect knedlach.
But it's also a preference, Howard, I think, how much you like, how fluffy you like it, or how hard you like it. And some people put what they call an ashoma, which is that cinnamon or whatever in the middle of it.
And
so what do you like? Do you like the hard or the soft?
Yeah. I actually like light and fluffy, but I often find them are completely tasteless. So my knedlach, I don't know.
The salt, the pepper, the cinnamon, and taste the batter. Doesn't taste so bad. Taste it. Make sure you're happy with the way it tastes from a seasoning point of view. And then you're good.
So Lauren, I don't know about your knedlach, but my knedlach has got ginger in, has got cinnamon in, and has ground almond. Very important for both texture as well as flavor. And don't forget some parsley, either fresh or herb. In, and you can almost adjust slightly all your combination to kind of give you the feel that your baba made it for you. But one of the questions that Lise just asked is, can you make knedlach in advance and freeze them and then boil them in salt water or in the soup on the night?
So what I do is I actually boil my knedlach in the soup straight away, because what happens is they drink in that flavor of the delicious soup. And then you can freeze the soup with the knedlach and just reheat on the night. And they are absolutely perfect.
Or I know many people who do make their knedlach and then just boil it in the soup on the evening after they've unfrozen them. But you can freeze knedlach. They do freeze
100% them. You can. But you can't freeze my crayfish.
That's something I learned today. I will make my fish and my sauce separately and take it with to Skakuza. And at the Nyati house in Skakuza, if any of you are around, please pop in to have some knedlach and mock crayfish in Skakuza for first and second night seder.
Marvelous. So should we get onto the video and see what else we can discover?
Thank you. Hello, everyone. I cannot believe it. I'm not even saying I can't believe it's Pesach again, because actually it is, and everything's got these Pesach stickers, and yeah, here we are. So I thought we'd go back to basics and just talk about how to make simple chicken soup. Because in reality, by the time you actually put the chicken soup on the stove and cook it yourself, it's quicker than going to the shops and standing in the queues and waiting and ordering, and it really is a 5-minute exercise, and I'm going to show you how to do it. So these are the ingredients that you will need for your chicken soup. So this is what you're going to need for your chicken soup. A chicken. In lots of the recipes, they call it a broiler or an old chicken. I actually don't. I like a nice, fresh, juicy chicken, because actually the quality of the ingredients is going to determine the quality of your soup. I also like to put in a little bit of top rib or flank, because somehow it gives the soup a bit of a depth of flavor. If you don't want to, don't do it. It's not imperative to the soup, but I like to do it, and then I mince it afterwards to make pirogan if it's not Pesach, or to put into my creams like for Pesach. You're also going to need some leeks, which I've already washed and cleaned, some carrots, an onion, a couple of parsnips, some celery, and some parsley. And then again, what you're going to put into your soup is going to add to the flavor of the soup. So really, the more vegetables you put, the more tasty your soup's going to be, but not so many that you can't actually get water in and you end up with no soup. I also like to add a little bit of cut pumpkin to the soup, because that gives it a beautiful yellow color. Once the soup is cooked, you're going to need some chicken cubes. If it's not Pesach, I use the Marcel, otherwise the Telma chicken cubes. So I like to start off by boiling my top rib first. The reason being is that the bones produce a little bit of scum. That's that fluffy white stuff that comes to the top of the water. And I like to actually then, once the meat is boiled, take the meat out, rinse it, throw away the dirty water, and then add all my soup ingredients. And that way you're going to get a beautiful clear soup. So my meat's all beautifully washed. I've got some clear water in my pot. I'm going to put in my chicken into the soup. My vegetables are going to go in. And that's it, a 2-minute exercise, and I'm going to have the most delicious chicken stock that will make enough soup for 2 seders and the Friday night as well, and you might even have some spare. This leftover pumpkin, you can drizzle with a bit of olive oil, some maple syrup, roast in the oven at 200, and that goes beautifully with your meat. So I'm going to put the lid on the pot, and it's going to boil like this for 5 hours. It's going to come to the boil. I'm going to reduce the heat once it's boiling. The only thing you have to do in the 5 hours is just keep topping up the water. So hello again, and welcome to the morning after. It doesn't really have to be the morning after, but I do like to put my soup into the fridge overnight, because what happens is that a layer of fat forms on top of the soup, as you can see. And I'm going to take that layer of fat off the soup, and then I'll show you, and you're left with a beautiful clear stock. So I'm just gently removing the fat from on top of the soup. What I forgot to tell you is, when the soup was ready after 4 or 5 hours yesterday, all I did was just strain the vegetables and the chicken and the meat out of the soup. And sometimes I mince up that meat and I use it for my pirogan, or I use it for a cottage pie during Pesach. Now, this isn't your soup. This is a stock. The stock, this amount of stock, can actually make 4 meals worth of soup. So at this point, what I do is I divide the soup into 4 portions, 3 or 4 portions, obviously depending on how many guests you've got. And that stock I'm going to mix with boiling water and chicken cubes to make a gorgeous chicken soup. So I'm going to pour some of the soup into a pot. Right, that amount of stock is absolutely enough for 12 people, because I'm going to mix it with boiling water and a few stock cubes and salt. I'm going to put it on the stove to boil, pouring some boiling water into my pot. pretty much towards the top of the pot. And I'm going to put in, I think, two of these giant 14 kilogram Marcel cubes. I'm going to use Marcel because this isn't Pesach dikker soup. And I much prefer the Marcel during the year. To start,
put in
a spoon and a half of salt. And I'm going to stir this and bring it to the boil. So I'm going to stir until it dissolves.
Made a mistake.
You see, I've got a beautiful look, clear soup. No fat, no globules of anything, and it's absolutely beautiful. The chicken stock can actually be used when a recipe calls for chicken stock. So you could freeze them in small containers and use that as a beautiful homemade chicken stock. But I think it does need another cube and just another half a teaspoon of salt. So let's put that in. There we go. Efficient. There you have it, your beautiful chicken soup, all ready for your Pesach Seder, and we're ready to move on to the Knedlach. So you know my feeling on Jewish food, that you have to taste it, touch it, feel it, and kind of do it by your heart, but for me, Knedlach don't work like that. So for the last couple of years, I've been lucky enough to be making my beautiful friend Lauren's Knedlach, and these, I guarantee you 100% will not flop. For the Knedlach, you're going to need four eggs, some room temperature water, some schmaltz, salt, pepper, there's your salt, and some matzo meal. And I'm going to show you how easy it actually is to make these Knedlach. So I'm going to start off by putting my four eggs into the bowl. To that, I'm going to add 4 level tablespoons of schmaltz. This is the Boolkin schmaltz. A tablespoon. My 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 tablespoons of schmaltz. And I'm just going to whisk it all together. There's your beautiful egg and schmaltz mixture. To that, I'm going to add 4 tablespoons of tap water. I'm going to add a teaspoon of salt. I think about a level teaspoon because the soup has salt and the Knedlach are actually going to drink the salt from the soup. A little bit of black pepper. A pinch of cinnamon. Let's do it like this. I would normally just hoi, but I think I better be careful. A pinch of cinnamon. And 4 rounded tablespoons of matzo meal. You're going to add 14 rounded tablespoons of matzo meal to the mixture. I'm just going to give this a mix up. Okay, so this is how your mixture looks. It's almost like a kind of thick cake batter. And I'm ready to put it now into my boiling soup. I know I keep harping on, but you saw this took me 2 minutes. The soup took me 10 minutes, and really it was quicker than going to the shops and standing in the queues. We're ready now to go and put the Knedlach into the pot to cook. I'm going to bring my soup back to the boil. It might take a few minutes, because you really do need to put the Knedlach into fast boiling water. Well, not really boiling water, boiling soup. And this amount of Knedlach is going to be enough for about 12 people. But people eat more than one, so I guess 7 or 8 people. You'll get 12 to 14 Knedlach after this, out of this mixture. So my soup's boiling beautifully. I'm just going to wet my hands a little bit. And I'm going to roll balls, I guess the size of a ping pong ball. Here we go, a beautiful knedler. I'm going to put the lid on, go off to wash my hands, and we'll check back in 20 minutes. So the 20 minutes has gone by, and I managed to restrain myself, remarkably enough, from opening the lid. And now I've got to restrain myself again and not eat one, because they look luscious, delicious, and buttery soft. Look at this. Soft as anything. Beautiful, delicious knedlach. Happy Pesach, everyone.
Wow, Lauren, you know what I love is that we're talking about traditional food and doing it the traditional way, but actually I don't think any two people have exactly the same traditional way. Like I've never seen top bread added to chicken soup, and I know there's always the conversation or the discussion, the whole chicken versus the carcass, and everyone's got their own opinion on what works, and then putting the vegetables back. You don't put any of the vegetables back. Some people mash the vegetables.
No, I like a clear soup. And having said that, I was really a bit slapdash about taking the fat of the soup because I wanted to get the video done. So really, when you look at the video, take more fat than I actually did off the soup. I could still see there was a bit, but I just wanted to finish it. The other thing that I said 4 tablespoons of matzo meal, but there's 14 tablespoons of matzo meal. And then something else I did wrong. Oh, I said a 14 kilogram stock cube, which is just physically not possible. It's a 14 gram stock cube.
So, Lauren, one of the questions is, what size eggs do you use?
Normally jumbo eggs, but I have taken to buying more of a free range kind of egg. And those were pretty much large, medium to large, and they work perfectly.
So I want to give some variations to people, because Joan tells us that she puts in nuts and fried onions. That's a German recipe. So
that, Jane, sounds delicious.
Sounds amazing. Please, can you post in the chat some more information? What nuts do you put them in? Do you grind them? What do you do? How do you fry the onions? If you could put that in the chat, I think that would be absolutely amazing. I think people would love to try that. Dina, I don't know about you. I mentioned earlier, I put in ground almonds, cinnamon, ginger, salt and pepper, Telma chicken soup, and parsley, dried parsley into mine as well. Where I differ to Lauren is I put mine in the fridge overnight, and I then make my balls the next day directly into the soup. And a trick given to me by Jonathan Bear is to use soda water rather than normal water in order to create
like a
fluffy knedlach.
Have you ever done? And it also, and I said in the chat as well, so I just want to bring in that comment. So someone said they use olive oil instead of schmaltz, because I was going to say, what is an alternative to schmaltz? Because not everyone uses schmaltz these days.
Definitely olive oil, because schmaltz is essentially a vegetable fat. So olive oil would work perfectly well.
Perfect. Jonna Howard, on your question, is I'm a traditionalist. My family's tradition, so I've always gone by them. So more of the plain ones.
And Nadine wants to know, do you cut up your vegetables? And Lauren, one of the things that I saw you didn't do, you put your vegetables directly into the pot. Dina, I don't know if you remember in one of our earlier webinars when we made vegetable soup, we had someone who said you must fry your vegetables at the bottom of your pot before you start it. Lauren didn't do that. Lauren, do you fry your vegetables or do you just stick them straight?
I plonk them in because I want quick and easy, and I like to cook with fresh stuff, fresh herbs, fresh vegetables, even my meat and my fish during Pesach. I don't really add all those bought sauces. I'm happy just to use olive oil and beautiful lemon juice and fresh herbs from the garden. And having said that, I have got Dolores's sweet chili recipe if you'd like, because that would work beautifully with the brisket. So I can read that to you if you want, or I can
Well, just email it through to us. We'll include that in our recipes we send out. Jamie says, I ate your veggie chopped liver recipe and my mouth is watering again for this. Oh, this is fantastic.
Come home, Jamie. We need you back.
Jamie, of course, is your son, your son in Israel, who missed all the excitement last night because he went to bed early. Denise Breyer wants to know, which matzah meal do you use?
I just happened to use the matzah meal I had in the freezer from last year, which was the Israeli matzah meal. I found that it doesn't make such a huge difference. The only difference it does make is the color. So the imported Manischewitz Rekusens is much whiter than the Israeli matzah meal. But from a taste point of view, it doesn't make a huge difference.
And
well, here's the question. How long? I just wanted to ask you, can you freeze your matzah meal? Because some people put it in the freezer for next year.
I put it in the freezer. Find out your view on that. And I keep it there for the solid year, and the date is for the year. And what I found is that actually they make it expire just before Pesach the next year. But I keep it in the freezer and it's absolutely perfect.
And Francis is saying that if you use olive oil rather than schmaltz, use the least pungent olive oil. Otherwise, the flavor of the olive oil can affect the flavor of the knedlach. And Tanya's telling us that her grandmother came from the shtetl and they baked knedlach in the oven. Tanya, if you can get us a recipe for that, I think there'll be so many people who would absolutely love to try that. So
I would
please,
kill for that recipe. I would love
please
to know.
Please, Tanya, go look through the old books and see what your grandmother taught you. But we'd love to share that recipe with people. And of course, Paula is saying, please, can we email her the recipes? If you've registered for this webinar, we're going to send out all the recipes and we're going to include a number of the ones from Melissa Mayer. And Lauren, you're going to give us Pesach sweet chili sauce recipe to include as well in the list that we send out.
This recipe, I mean, the sweet chili is fabulous. It's Dolores's recipe. My kids put it on everything right the way through Pesach, and I think it would work beautifully with the brisket instead of the Nando's sweet chili.
And Jamie wants to know if you can make his Canada in an air fryer.
That was a win.
I've actually got no idea. Can you?
We're going to find out. And Yael says, how much oil do you use instead of schmaltz?
I would do exactly the same quantity.
Yeah. There was a lot of schmaltz you put in.
I put in, how much did I put in? Four tablespoons of schmaltz. I would still do the 4 tablespoons of olive oil, but maybe I would weigh it on a scale just to double check the actual weight of the olive oil versus the schmaltz. What do you think?
Well, if you can also, you don't have to use olive oil. You can use normal Pesach oil, sunflower oil as well, if you want something that's not as flavorful too. But Lauren, let's check that up. And when we send out your recipes tomorrow, let's include something from that in it.
I'll do that. Thank you for having me.
And Desiree, just before you go, says that her late Boba baked the knedlach as well. You take the boiled balls, you put a little schmaltz over them, and you bake till crispy, and it's absolutely delicious.
I'm so doing that.
See, we've totally taken what we called was the traditional and turned it upside down.
And I love the fact that Ray says she keeps her in the freezer for 2 years, her matzah meal, it never goes off. And you know, Ray, even if it did go off, it would taste exactly the same as well.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Lauren, thanks so much. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Happy Pesach, everyone. Bye-bye.
Yeah, bye.
Goodbye. Thank you so much. And now moving to abroad but local with Miriam. Miriam, can you turn on your camera? So Howard, Miriam is actually the only official Sephardi chef that we have tonight.
Right, okay. Why cannot go on video?
Miriam, give me 1 second. I may have turned your video off. So yes. let me just find you. And you should have got a message that asked you
video,
to start the video.
Yeah. Okay.
Welcome back.
Yes, you. So Miriam, you the authentic Sephardi Moroccan Israeli chef. We love having that diversity, and we're so excited to have you, and we have you on local shores.
Oh, thank you.
So, Miriam, tell us something. Where did you learn to cook? So where were you actually born?
I was born in Israel, and I learned to cook, obviously, from home, from my mother. And, we used to traditional Moroccan food because my mom came from Morocco. She immigrated to Israel, so she cooked all the Moroccan food. And that's what we ate, like, for Pesach and every day.
So what's an everyday dish, like an everyday Moroccan, like, dinner? What is your favorite thing to cook?
Okay, couscous, it's a very, like, famous traditional dish that people are cooking, you know, and my mom used to make it delicious, really delicious. And, you know, even Moroccan, there is different areas, so the cooking is slightly different. So in our tradition, in my house, we used to eat couscous with sugar and cinnamon, you know? We cooked it with all that veggie soup and everything, and we used to put some sugar and cinnamon, yeah. But other Moroccan, they don't even know how can you eat couscous with sugar and cinnamon. That's how it was in my house. Anyway.
So Miriam, having traveled through Morocco, couscous is a traditional Friday night meal in Morocco, because you feel very full. It's almost like the end of the week meal in many Moroccan places.
But in my house, it wasn't on Friday, because Friday night we cooked fish, Moroccan fish. We cook meat, chicken, stuff like that. But couscous we used to cook like during the week, or maybe, you know, in our tradition, when you move to a new house, it's like a blessing to cook a couscous, and we used to eat couscous for like housewarming. Yeah.
All right. Someone and now tell us about
Dina. Someone sent me a wonderful meme of two kids sitting on the back of a truck, and the one kid says to the other, "Did you say a blessing before you eat?" And the other kid says, "I don't have to. My mother's Sephardi, our food tastes perfect as it is."
I love it. I love it.
Okay.
I also wanted to ask, see Miriam Rich, because she knows it's true. I wanted to say, you do the mimuna as well. So I don't think any of the Ashkenazi.
We do the mimuna, yeah. Mimuna, we do mufleta. You know what is mufleta? It's like a dough that you open like this, and then you put in a frying pan, and you eat it with the butter and honey. And actually, mimuna, it's all sweet, all about sweet stuff, like that Moroccan cookies that are very sweet and all that stuff. Yes, we do it. Right.
So, yeah, very unfamiliar. So tonight for Pesach, you are making us something which I tasted earlier, which I was like blown. It was so delicious. And you told me it was so simple, but it was so, so delicious. Tell us what you're making for us tonight.
It's like a matzah roll with mincemeat inside. And it's very easy, very quick. It's really easy and quick. It's the easiest thing to do. So I'm sure everyone that watched that video can make it. It's very easy.
All right. Cool. Yeah. So, you know, let's watch it and then we'll come back.
Okay, thanks.
Now we're going to do matzah wrap with mince balls. So first, I chop the onion, small. And in the meantime, you can put some oil on the stove, that we can fry the onion. Put some oil to fry the onion. And this is like Moroccan tradition for Pesach. It's a traditional dish that we make for Pesach. Okay, I fry the onion. As you see, it's lots of onion. But after I fry it, it won't be that much. Okay, now Let's put some spices into the mincemeat. Can you show the mincemeat here? I took one pack of about 400 grams. And I'm going to put here, I don't know how it's called in English, but it's called barak in Hebrew. So please translate from Hebrew, I don't know. It's come from Israel, little bit. And I do like this, I need to do it with a spoon, and they will know how much. Anyway, and this is English paper. I'm putting a little bit of English paper because it's quite strong, this one. Then, chicken powder. Little bit of salt. Now let's mix it. Come show up, please. Come closer. I need to mix it with all the spices. It can taste nice. Okay. Sorry, I have to use my hand because that's the only way that you can mix it nicely. Then this one. Still need to fry. Oh, and in the meantime, I need to wet the matzah because matzah need to sit about 20 minutes with the water. So let me wet the matzah nicely. Lots of water, as you see, it needs to be very wet. And now I'm going to put it into a clean towel, kitchen towel, but it must be clean or even brand new. Yeah, let me fold it nicely, soft. It will soften it. Now let's put the mince on. Now mince meat. Now I'm mixing the mincemeat in, and you keep break it like this because otherwise it will be big pieces and you don't want it. You want it to be like spread all over in small. Like a full spoon of pine nuts. That's more or less the amount that you have to mix in. After it is ready, we mustn't cook it too much because we need it like this. Okay, now it's fine. Fill it into the matzah. It will be filled into the matzah, and then we're going to fry. Dip it in an egg, and we will fry it. We need all the oil to go off that. So let's put it in here, that the oil will come out. Sorry, forgot about it. It must come out. All the oil must come out. We don't want so much oil in there. So first we let the oil come out of this. Okay. Now I took two eggs, I mix them, I shake them, and I leave it here on a plate. Now frying pan with oil. Now we put the oil on the stove to get hot. We shake two eggs here, and then I put some of that mincemeat. Show that mincemeat, please. Yes, into the matzah that I took from there, and now I start to roll it like this. Then I will dip it into the egg, you see, like this. Good. And then right into the frying pan. Okay, now we put some minced meat here, and then let's roll that nicely, like this, good. And then let's put in the, dip it in the egg. That's the second one. Ah, it's going well. Now, 2 minutes to fry from the other side, to be fried. Let's put, now, let's put here pepper towel, just to absorb the oil from the matzah. Yeah, looks stunning. Wow. Beautiful. Look at this, that's beautiful. We put it on that pepper towel just to absorb this.
Well, you can see your grandson certainly enjoyed them. And I can tell you for a fact, delicious, delicious. And you make it look so simple, but it was unbelievable.
But it is very simple to make, as you see. It's very easy. I mean, it's so quick and easy.
Miriam, one of the key things is a spice that you said was called barat.
Yes, barat.
So let's just tell everyone what barat is, because you can make it yourself. So inside barat is black pepper, cardamom, cloves, cumin, nutmeg, coriander, and paprika. I'll read that again, but we'll include it in the recipe that we send out. There's black pepper, cardamom, cloves, cumin, nutmeg, coriander, and paprika. And you can go and buy it at Woolworths. Woolworths do stock it. But Dina, I don't know about you, in October, Woolworths decided to not carry their one product that they had from Israel, which was pearl couscous from Israel, under pressure from the BDS movement. I have not walked into a Woolworths store since October last year. It's been over 6 months that I haven't shopped at Woolworths. And I don't have any intention of shopping at Woolworths until they return their one Israeli product back into the store. I personally don't support stores that support the boycott of Israel. So I will not be going to buy my barat from Woolworths. I'll be making it myself, and I'll put the ingredients into the chat. And it's black pepper, cardamom, cloves, cumin, nutmeg, coriander, and paprika. I'll put that into the chat so everyone can go buy that themselves or make that themselves.
Or even better yet, you can go get your own in Israel.
Exactly. I'll bring you something.
Absolutely. And now someone's asked, can you freeze these?
Sorry, if you can freeze it.
Frozen these, yeah.
I haven't tried to freeze it, but I'm sure you can. Yes, but then, after you take it out, you have to warm it in the oven that it will come crispy again. Otherwise, like in the microwave, you won't have that crisp on the matzah, you know?
So, absolutely.
Susan wants to know, can you bake them rather than fry them?
I don't know, because you have to stick them with that egg. You know, when I top it with the egg, it's like keep it stick together. Now, if you bake them, what's going to stick them? I don't know.
And then also, and then the air fryer.
Maybe she can try it. Yeah, maybe. I don't know. But you have to put that side that you fold at the bottom, that it won't open while you fry them. Just put it in a tray in the oven. I'm sure it will be fine. Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, I'm sure she can.
And now there's also a question. See, the air fryer is very popular. Someone asks if you can fry them in the air fryer.
Yes, you can. Yes. Air fryer, it's the easiest way to do it, actually. But again, they must put that part that you fold, the last part, like at the bottom, not on the top, that it won't open, you know? Even when I fry them, I put that bottom, that part in the bottom that it will hold together and won't open.
Okay, so let's just see. So how they put in the ingredients for bread? Where do you get your spices in Israel?
Oh, well, there is a spice shop, a special spices shop in Israel, but it's everywhere. Any, even in the supermarket, you can buy it. All these spices in Israel, you can find it anywhere, even in a supermarket. But I go to a spice shop that they are specialized in spices, and then I get it like fresh and it's nicely done. The one in the tins, they're not, you know, they're not as good as the, they're not as fresh as the ones you buy from the special shop for spices.
And a huge thank you to Judith, who's in fact given us a recipe, 2 teaspoons of coriander seeds, 1 tablespoon of cumin seeds, 1 tablespoon of white cloves, 1 tablespoon of black peppercorns, 1/2 stick of cinnamon, some cardamom pods, a good grating of nutmeg, and 2 tablespoons of paprika, not smoked. And you ground that all together, and that will give you your barat spice.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Fantastic. Okay. Miriam, yeah, that looks absolutely delicious. I'll be right over after the show. Please keep me some.
Okay, I will definitely. Yes. Yes, actually, we do have, yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us this evening.
Thank you for having me. Thanks, everyone. And have a good and happy Pesach.
Chag kosher. Pesach to you and to the entire family, and so happy that you're all joining together in South Africa.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Bye. So bye. It looks like Dina has frozen a little bit. Dina, are you back with us? If not, let me just quickly get Dina's running order and we will continue immediately with the show, because if you haven't had a chance yet to make a donation to the Jewish Report, we want to give you one last chance to make a donation to the Jewish Report and to join the Jewish Report family. And of course, if you do tonight, you'll be able to win a whole bunch of prizes, including an amazing air fryer, toaster machines, Eiger air fryer, Eiger post. Toasting machines, a whole bunch of wine as well. So if you'd still like to make a donation to the Jewish Report and you haven't yet done so, we're going to put up our poll one last time to allow you to make a donation and to thank everyone, all of our professional staff who for putting the newspaper together, the webinars together, for putting all of this together. So Dylan, if I can ask you to please put up the poll to allow people to make a donation. And for those people who are watching us tonight on YouTube and on Zoom, if I'm sure there's a link that you've posted there as well to allow people to make a donation to the Jewish Report as well. So please, this is your chance. If you haven't made a donation and you'd very much like to, this is your opportunity if you can afford to be able to do it. And with that, while people make a donation, we'd love to welcome our next guest, who's Juliet Sack. So Juliet, if we can ask you, your camera is back on. Welcome back with us.
Hi, looking forward to this.
So you've never been on one of our cooking shows before. What do we have in store?
Well, I'm doing an unusual dish. As I said to you, I love cooking all the traditional food, but this is something a little bit different for people that want a Passover with a difference. My dish is a sweet and sour marinated salmon with horseradish sauce, And anybody's free to ask me about substitutes for anything. And this is just something different and something that you can also make in advance, 2 or 3 days in advance, and it actually gets better and better the longer you keep it.
And do you serve this as a main course or is this a starter for you? Tell us how it fits into your meal.
You know what? Sometimes you people do a cold meal. It depends on the temperature or the weather that we're having. But I would say it can be a starter or a main. It just depends how you want to serve it. I know we've had cold meals on the occasion, especially with the load shedding, etc. So, you know, it's something that you can use anytime, either as a starter or as a main.
Okay, fantastic. Shall we watch your video and we'll come back and talk to you and you'll give some guidance and some substitutes. And also maybe there's some vegans who are watching us this evening. I saw there were some people looking for vegan version of Canada, but maybe if the sauce is interesting, maybe we can put it over something else as well. So let's watch your video.
Hi, welcome to my kitchen. This is where all the amazing cooking takes place. Sometimes it's one hell of a mess, but tonight I will try and keep it neat for you viewers. We're making a wonderful Passover dish. It's a little bit different. It's a salmon dish. It's sweet and sour marinated salmon with a horseradish sauce. Feel free to use salmon trout also, which is not as costly as Norwegian salmon. Right, we're going to start with the sweet and sour mixture first. You need a medium-sized pot and sliced red onions. We're now going to put the pot on the stove and we're going to add our oil and slightly sweat the onions till a little bit soft. Heat 3 tablespoons of oil in a medium pot and put your onions in. Make sure the pot is not too hot so that you don't burn the onions. The onions must sweat nicely. Once they have sweated for approximately 5 minutes, that is when you're going to add your raisins. Our pan is heating at the moment, our nonstick pan. We're going to get ready to cook our salmon. First, before we do that, I'm just going to add the raisins to the onion mixture and carry on sweating the onions. As I said before, be careful that you don't burn these onions. Otherwise, the taste of your dish is going to be horrible and you're going to have a mess. Next step is to fry the salmon. Please, if you can, use a non-stick frying pan. Always best for fish, otherwise you get that sticky residue and it's difficult to turn. So I'm going to now work on my salmon. For the salmon, we're going to use matzo meal for a crust. Obviously, because this is a seder, you're going to use matzo meal or potato starch or mix both, or if you want just matzo meal. So we're now going to coat the salmon in the matzo meal, ready to fry it. With our non-stick frying pan, heat the pan till hot and then add your oil, ready to fry your salmon. Great, let's start now with breading our salmon in the matzo meal mixture. Here we are breading our matzo meal mixture. Please remember to add seasoning because seasoning is what makes all dishes delectable. Never be shy with salt or pepper. Now
Now on to our second step of frying the fish. Make sure the oil is hot enough that the fish sits nicely in it. Let's try a piece and see. Ah, perfect. Add your pieces of fish and let's lightly brown them. Watch the fish while it's cooking so that it does not burn. Let's have a look and have a slight peek. Perfect. Make sure that your oil is fairly hot so that it sears the outside of the fish nicely. Remove the browned fish from the pan, making sure that it's not overcooked. Drain the fish on paper towel. As you can see, it's nicely browned. You want some browned bits to give it a bit of crunch. While our fish has been cooking, we've had the onions sweating with the raisins. It's time now to add the rest of the ingredients. Bay leaves. Add the black peppercorns, add the sugar, add the water. Here is our sweet and sour mixture with the sugar in, black peppercorns and bay leaves and water. Now let's add our vinegars and wine. We're going to add 1 cup of dry white wine. Here I've got my 1 cup balsamic ready to go in. I know it seems like a huge amount of balsamic, but that's what adds the zing to our sweet and sour salmon. Now the wonderful thing about this dish is that it can be made 2 days before and it gets better with time. Last but not least, I'm going to add my white wine vinegar. And we're going to bring this to the boil. Here is our mixture with all the ingredients in it. Cook it on a medium heat till slightly reduced and check the flavor after 5 minutes. Here we have our salmon fully cooked. Make sure that it's nice and browned and not too raw in the middle. Leave it on, depending on the size of the steaks, for 4 to 5 minutes or 2 to 3, depending, as I said, on the thickness. As we wait now for our sweet and sour mixture, we place this on the side. Our sweet and sour sauce is bubbling away here, as you can see. Let's just get it to reduce slightly and get a good flavor in it. Now I'm going to test for seasoning. Here we go for a test of seasoning. This is how you make your food very good. Okay, great. The flavor is amazing, but it is missing something, and the missing ingredient is salt and black pepper. Salt, a big amount. Add your black pepper. After tasting and adding my salt and pepper, I'm now going to give a slight second taste to see if the seasoning is correct. I think it needs more salt. You all going to kill me and tell me that I'm a very, very unhealthy person, but unfortunately, I love salt. And in my opinion, to balance this dish, you need a little bit of salt with the sweet and sour. Horseradish sauce, as you can see, this is white, not pink. When you can't find what you need, you just make a plan. So my plan is using white horseradish. You could add a little bit of beetroot to it to make it pink. So we add our horseradish into the bowl. Add the horseradish and the sour cream to taste to your liking. Our sweet and sour mixture is ready, perfectly seasoned as it should be. Please pour over the fish And as I said, the nice thing about this particular dish, the longer it stands, the better it tastes. Voila! Here is a perfect sweet and sour marinated salmon ready for your Pesach Seder. Just garnish it nicely to finish off, and hopefully it will be a delectable feast and a delectable Passover.
Howard, I don't know about you, but my mouth is watering. Even though I do think, Juliet, that is a lot of salt. I do agree.
I just love salt. I think, you know what, when you go out and eat, or I could be rude and say go to other people's homes, often there's no salt in the food. And if you are making food, don't forget about seasoning, because that is sort of, you know, what is going to bring all the flavor into the food. You always see on MasterChef at the end of the meal, they say, you know what, the reason you failed is there wasn't enough seasoning in your food.
Absolutely. Now tell me, so the difference between, because I know we've actually used to only use salmon, and now we also talk about salmon trout. What is your favorite and what is your preference?
Well, definitely Norwegian salmon. We actually only get fresh Norwegian here. About 15 years ago, we used to get magnificent Scottish, but not anymore. It's too expensive. And also with this dish, you could use kingklip. It's got to be a firm fish. Otherwise, when you fry it and let it stand, it's going to fall to pieces. So it's got to be a firm fish. But salmon trout is fine. I think it's called salmon trout. I'm not 100%.
So Juliet, sure. you had thick pieces of salmon. Salmon trout is usually, well, salmon trout's neither salmon nor trout, but it's usually very thin.
Yes, you've got to look for the centerpiece. So not the end pieces. So you don't want the tail section. It's got to be the centerpiece. And you've also got to look at your fish before you buy it and ask the fishmonger or when you look at it at the shop that it is a thick enough piece.
Susan is asking, was that salmon that you used that looked like whitefish, the salmon that they get in North America is pink?
No, it was definitely pink.
No, it was pink.
It was just bad coloring. I don't know. Sorry, it was definitely good Norwegian salmon.
And we've got some vegans watching us. So let us say they don't want to use fish. And I presume you can do something similar for a chicken as well, similar sort of sauce. But what can we substitute in? Could we do eggplant or butternut or pumpkin as a base for something in that sauce as well?
Or tofu.
Yes, and I think butternut might break up, but eggplant is wonderful and firm and it'll lend itself to pickling. You probably could use carrots boil or steam a little bit beforehand so that they are slightly cooked and then they can marinate. This particular dish is served at room temperature. So, I mean, you could have sweet and sour vegetables to start for the vegetarians. But I mean, then as I say that, there's also magnificent chopped liver. That's for vegetarian people, where you use mushrooms and nuts.
So Ross is asking, did you put cream and horseradish into the onions?
No.
What did you put into the onions?
The horseradish sauce is separate. As I said, you can just serve, well, you haven't seen the recipe yet, but you can serve the fish just with simple plain grain, or you can make the horseradish sauce with a bit of sour cream, depending on what your meal is for the evening. milk or meat or whatever to suit you.
And of course, you can make horseradish sauce with mayonnaise and grain as well.
Exactly. And maybe to throw in a little bit of dill with that would be extra delicious with the salmon. So, you know, you can play around.
Melissa is saying that for vegetables, you could use carrots, peppers, onions, cucumbers, and cauliflower. And Judith Katsu said she would love a recipe for vegetarian chopped liver. Juliet, are you willing to include when we send out the recipes, your recipe for vegetarian chopped liver, please?
Yes, vegetarian chopped liver is magnificent. And the mushrooms that you use is what gives it the amazing flavor. And the mushrooms actually taste like liver, which is quite unbelievable.
And you use nuts as well.
Yeah, and you use walnuts. I can't remember. It's onions, mushrooms, nuts, herbs, and spices. And then you chop it up like chopped liver. And it's a wonderful thing.
But you'll give us that recipe because there are a lot of people who don't eat liver because it's very high in cholesterol. So if there's a substitute that people can use, I think they'd absolutely love that.
No, it's wonderful. Sorry.
You always get more than you bargain for in our webinars.
Yes, an extra recipe. I'll send through an extra recipe of vegetarian chopped liver.
Amazing. Well, Juliet, well done. And thank you so much. And we wish you the best of luck with your cooking school and your whole new venture. It's very, very exciting times.
Thank you. And everybody have a wonderful Passover.
Thanks, Juliet. Thanks so much. Denise, you said anyone has advice for making your own, it would be fresher. It's grain. Maybe I can lean on my father's watching to give us a recipe for his grain. Dina, I know our parents compete on who makes the better and stronger grain.
Absolutely. It's actually a very, very tough competition every single year. And neither of them ever actually concede. So that's kind of
Dad, I'm sure you're watching. I need your grain recipe, please.
And my dad too. So yes, you have to get, it's all about the root. It's actually all about what you get. Then you actually mince it. And then it is making the beetroot. So the more you cry, the happier they are. But it's fierce. And there's also a bit of, I think it's, and I might get this wrong, but it's vinegar, sugar, beetroot, and the actual root of the herb. We shall see.
We shall see. So Dina, our last chef for the evening, who is that?
This is who we call Chef Dan. Chef Dan. So Chef Dan also is a culinary wizard who actually, so when I was speaking to him about it, so he's one of our what we call fresh faces that we found on Joburg Jewish Mommies. He was very, very, very well recommended by so many. So clearly he's done some great work and some very tasty work. And we are actually so excited for him to have his debut on our actual webinar. And when we were discussing what he was going to make, he said to me, you know, well, I don't often make this crazy stuff, but I did make this really, really interesting recipe, which we sort of when he actually alluded to it, I was like thinking of what we had actually done for Achievers. And I thought, no, he is definitely coming on. So Chef Dan, welcome. Daniel Kusner officially, but Chef Dan, commonly known as.
Thank you. Thanks welcome very much.
So tell us, how long have you been cooking?
I've been a professional chef now for 5 years. I went to culinary school, so I've got the title. and then the last 3 years, I've become a kosher chef exclusively. So I've become more religious, and now I have stopped working in trade restaurants and things like that about 3 years ago, and here we are today.
So Dan, tell us to in order to earn your chops, where have you worked and how do we get you? Do you come to people's homes to cook? Do you cook in your home? So where have you been and how do we get your services?
So I've worked in a lot of restaurants throughout Johannesburg. I worked at the Johannesburg Country Club. I worked at the Houghton Hotel. I worked at What's that tall building in Sandton called? The big one.
The Leonardo.
The Leonardo. I was in there at one stage. And now, yeah, now I cook mainly from a house if I'm doing that type of thing. But I tend to cook a lot in people's homes as a personal chef. People will hire me out to cook that way. Yeah, my business is just me at the moment. I'm the CEO, CFO, marketing manager, everything. So I'm not exactly equipped to cater for 150, 250 people, but yeah, I just try to make every dish as special as I can, even if it's on a smaller scale.
Amazing. So what are you cooking for us this evening?
So initially, and Dina alluded to it earlier when we spoke on the phone, and I think I discussed it a little bit in my actual video, we discussed this gefilte fish dish that I made back when I was in culinary school. So we had not exactly a competition, it was more like an assignment we had to do called Dish of Distinction. And at that stage, I was already sort of coming back to my Jewish heritage. You know, I was a bit off the derrick at that stage, I hate to admit, but it's the truth. And I was, you know, I was slowly learning more. I was reading some Jewish cookbooks at the time that I picked up. And I made this like really insane gefilte fish dish. There was like a molecular gastronomy type thing, you know, like Heston Blumenthal kind of vibes. What I actually did was I spherified lemon juice into like little pearls. And then I've had that on top of my, that was sort of my garnish. And I thought to myself, you know, no one in, at least I don't think the South African Jewish community is going to go out and look for Pesach to buy sodium alginate and calcium carbonate, which is what you need to make that dish happen. And
which just so happens to actually be kosher. You can get them from America. Yes. And they're completely kosher. Do you use an electronic pearl maker, or do you use one of those that you inject into a mold?
No. So I just make the solution and then I'll use like a pipette and just drop them into that solution and they spherify straight away.
$89 buy off Amazon an electronic pearl maker.
Yeah, I've seen those. Yeah. But, you know, I don't really do that type of food anymore. I've more shifted now to a focus on Hamish cooking, you know, really just homegrown, really loving food. But I do still put my own twist and my own spin on things. You know, I try and incorporate what I've learned over my years working everywhere that I've worked and all the different places I've traveled over the years. I try to incorporate that as well in my cooking.
Dina thinks I'm insane that I know about electronic pearl makers. And don't ask me about phone machines, because I can actually answer that question as well.
And well, I know he's done research into this, don't worry. So I'm not shaking my head, but I actually am.
Well, I actually put a kitchen blowtorch on my wedding registry, and one of my friends phoned me up when he saw that, and he was like, Daniel, are you okay? Like, no, I'm not buying you a blowtorch for your wedding.
Welding, it's all for welding. Let's watch the video, and then we'll come back with some questions.
Absolutely.
Hello everybody, hope you're doing well. My name is Chef Dan, if you've never met me. My full name is Daniel Kusner, but everyone just calls me Chef Dan. Here we are, in my parents' kitchen, just by the way. My kitchen's not this busy, but my kitchen's also like one iota of the size. So we decided it would be better to film this here. And yeah, I just want to say a massive thank you to the South African Jewish Report for giving me this opportunity. I was so excited when Dina called me last week and said, do I want to do it? I was like over the moon. I can't even tell you. I was so, so, so excited. And yeah, Dina and I spoke a little bit about what to cook, and we spoke about what everyone else was cooking. And yeah, I've decided today that we're going to do a dessert, because as far as I know, everybody else for this webinar was doing some savouries, you know, there was some soup and canadle going on, so I thought, why not, let's have something sweet. You know, we haven't had the best time the last 6 months with everything that's going on with our brothers and sisters in Eretz Yisrael, so let's have something sweet to sweeten up our lives, sweeten our Pesach, and yeah. All right, so today I've decided to make what's known as matzah crack. Thought, you know, we'll go with something sweet instead of the savouries. So it's called matzah crack because the finished dish, we're going to crack the matzah into like nice little shards. And the other reason it's called matzah crack is because it's incredibly difficult to resist this stuff. Super, super delicious. And you'll see just now. But just a little background, you know, when Dina and I were initially discussing what I was going to make for this webinar, I was talking about making some like high-end fine dining kind of dish, and we're talking about this gefilte fish dish that I made when I was back at culinary school. And it's like a very high-end concept. And I thought, you know, that's not really what I want to do, because that's not the type of food I do anymore since I've become religious and I've stopped working in non-kosher restaurants and hotels and things like that. My cooking has evolved, and I have now become more of a chef who cooks Hamish food, nice, delicious, home-cooked meals. I do still put my own flair and things like that, so that's what we're going to, I'm going to show you now, how I've gone around and changed the matzah crack a little bit, so it's not just plain old, you know, the standard recipe. So let's start off down here. The first one we're going to make is going to be with dark chocolate and sea salt, because dark chocolate and sea salt go so well together. Then I'm going to make a variation with white chocolate and the chocolate lentils, you know, the Pesach kind of like Smarties. And then we're also going to make a Mexican hot chocolate variant with the milk chocolate and some cinnamon and chili powder. So if you don't know, Mexican hot chocolate, it's very, very different to like European style hot chocolate. And it's got cinnamon and it's got chilies in it. Sometimes they use like adobo chilies and chipotle chilies. So it's this rich, creamy, chocolatey deliciousness, but it's also got chili and cinnamon. So it's got this depth of flavor to it that I can't exactly explain. You have to experience it for yourself. So that's the variations on standard matzah crack that I'm going to be doing here. Right, so step one is going to be to wrap your sheet tray that you're going to be using. The reason I wrap the sheet tray personally, I mean, you don't have to, but I do it because we're going to make a caramel now on the stove with the butter and the sugar. And that stuff is very hot and very sticky, and it sticks to everything, and it sticks to the sheet tray, and it's very hard to clean off. If you ever burnt sugar in your oven, you know, baking anything, you know how much of a pain it is once that sugar caramelizes and melts and starts to burn, how hard it is to get off. It's horrendous. So to save you that trouble, wrap the sheet tray in a little bit of tin foil. Helps so much. Also, the matzah comes off so nice and easy. And then just here we've got four sheets of matzah, and I've just broken the fifth one into halves. But you can make this to whatever scale you want. My recipe is scaled specifically for 4 to 5 pieces of matzah, but you can halve it if you're going to make a smaller batch of, say, 2 pieces of matzah, whatever your case might be. So the next step is we're going to measure out our butter and sugar. I've already got it here. I'm going to get this going on a medium heat, get the butter melting down, get the sugar dissolving into that, and get all of this caramelizing nicely. Also preheating my oven here to 200 degrees Celsius. If you're in Fahrenheit, if you're overseas or whatever, I'm sorry, I can't help you. We use metric. Then we're going to, once this caramel is done, I'm going to pour it onto our matzah, and that's going to go into the oven. So we can get the matzah to, we can get the caramel to spread out and solidify nicely. Okay, I might have said no knife skills, but we do need to just sort of rough chop the chocolate into just rough pieces. If you see other recipes online, they'll tell you to use chocolate chips or something. Because I know not everyone has a microwave on Pesach, or you know, you might not have the facility to melt the chocolate. So what we're going to do here is just rough chop it into little pieces, so that what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the chocolate directly onto the caramel, and the heat from the caramel is going to melt the chocolate. Alrighty, so here we go, we've got our caramel ready to go. I'm going to pour it now over our matzah, trying to spread it out. I've got a spatula here, so I'll spread it out with the spatula more evenly now, but let's just try and get it on as best we can. And please be very careful when you're doing this at home, because this stuff is very hot. And I don't want to hear from anyone that they accidentally got third degree burns from caramel, because I've seen that happen before in a kitchen. It's not fun. Really, really not fun. But it's worth it. It's going to be super delicious. All right. So now we're just going to try and spread out the caramel as evenly as we can across all the matzah. And please, again, be very careful because the stuff is very hot. And one thing that I forgot to mention earlier on when I was melting the caramel and making it there in the pot is that I put a pinch of salt. Of course, it's sugar in here. Put a pinch of salt into the caramel because salt just brings out the flavor nicely, and you know, salted caramel is a lovely thing. I didn't put enough to make it a salted caramel, just enough to bring out the flavor. But again, that's something that you can customize. If you want to make a salted caramel matzah crack, by all means, go for it. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to take our matzah and we're going to pop it into the oven. Do it the right way around, that would help. And we're going to cook the caramel a little bit longer now in the oven. Go ahead and do that. Now, I do want to mention that you need to watch this quite carefully. It's only going to be in the oven for a handful of minutes, maybe 5 to 7 minutes. But please watch it, because if it gets too hot, the sugar's going to burn, not nice, and then your whole batch is going to be ruined. So don't forget about it. Stay in the kitchen. Just make sure that it doesn't burn. Again, very, very short in the oven. Like my oven glass. Okay. Pull this out of the oven now. And you can see how nice and brown that's got it. Just going to put it here so we don't burn the table. My mother will kill me. Okay. There we go. Now what we're going to do without burning the oven glass, I'm going to go ahead with my dark chocolate, and I'm going to put this dark chocolate on here, and you can already see how the chocolate is starting to melt into the caramel, and I'm only doing a third of my tray here, so this is about, I think this was about half a bar of chocolate, because I'm doing three variations. That's variation number one. Variation number two is the light chocolate. And I'm just going to add some of the cinnamon and chili powder into here and mix it around so it's nice and coated. So that is our Mexican hot chocolate matzah crack. Oh, this smells amazing. I wish smell-o-vision was a thing and you could smell my kitchen right now, because this is delicious. Oh, amazing. And then last of all, you can just wipe my hands, because I don't want the white chocolate now to get all cinnamony and stuff. Here is our white chocolate, and that's our last variation over here. And this white chocolate is really nice, by the way, if you haven't tried it before. Really nice. And I'm not a fan of white chocolate. Alright, so here we go. I'm going to spread out my chocolate. And look at that, how nicely it's all melted down. Oh, I'm so excited. And I know that my sister is also very excited. My wife is also. They're both salivating. Lovely, lovely. Alrighty. Don't worry, I'm going to do the dishes just now. Yes, I do the dishes at home. Okay. There we go. There's our milk chocolate. Mexican hot chocolate version here. Very, very nice. There we go, there we go. And you can see now, I'm sure, why I used the tin foil, because some of the caramel's fallen through the crack there, and that caramel is going to be a nightmare to clean up later. So Yeah, probably a good idea, hey? Cool. There's our milk chocolate. And then last but not least, our white chocolate. Which I know not everyone's a fan of, but I think it's nice. I think there's such a cool thing you can do with white chocolate that you can't necessarily do with regular milk chocolate. So excited. I haven't made this stuff since Pesach last year. So I'm very, very excited. And now we're going to put our toppings. Just going to fix that up a little bit. Cool, now let's put our toppings. So, the dark chocolate is going to get some molten flaky sea salt, my favorite salt. And if you never had salt and chocolate together, or dark chocolate specifically, you're missing out. So just a little bit of flaky sea salt on the top there of our chocolate. The Mexican hot chocolate, I'm not putting anything because that's already got the cinnamon and chili powder in it. And then our white chocolate is going to get some of these beautiful lentils, not the kind you put in your soup, the kind that is the kosher for Pesach smarty equivalent, essentially speaking. And there we have it. Matzah crack three ways.
And by the power of movie magic, it is the next day. And I just left this out at room temperature, just lightly covered for the chocolate and everything to cool down and dry. If you've got space in your fridge, pop it in your fridge and let it cool down there. And I do recommend keeping it in the fridge thereafter. But yeah, we can now go ahead and crack this up. And it doesn't have to be perfect. And do all different size pieces, small, big. And just this is... make your pieces bigger or smaller as you like. This is a taste. This is the Mexican chocolate one that we did. So that's my favorite variation on this.
Oh, love that, Chef Dan. And I love the word you use, smell-o-vision. I think, is that your invention?
I don't think I've ever heard that before.
Dan, I just loved the look on the face when you tasted your own food. That was just absolutely priceless.
Thank you.
Exactly. A chef has to love their own food. But so, I actually love that.
So Dan, there were a few questions. The first question was, should you put spray and cook on the foil before you put your matzah in? Or is that not necessary?
No, not really necessary. That's why I put the tin foil down. Spray and cook's not really going to do much in that department.
Okay, then how much butter and sugar are you using?
So I know you said you're going to send the recipes out to everyone. So it's on there, but I do have it here next to me. Just quickly pull it out. So I use 220 grams of butter, or you can use margarine. I saw there was a question someone asked if we could make it pyro. I just struggled to find the kosher for Pesach margarine. I don't know, I just couldn't find it. And then I used 210 grams of brown sugar.
Okay, fantastic. And then the next question, how do we make the sugar-free carb-free?
Wow, I'm not
have some
sure.
Have some nuts, Howard. Have some nuts.
I'm gonna have some some almonds maybe and some macadamias.
Maybe some almonds coated in some sugar-free dark chocolate. That could work. I'm not sure how exactly to remove all the sugar.
And someone called the World Gone Mad says on YouTube, it's highly addictive. I can attest to that. And Michelle says you can use oil instead of butter since Pesach margarine is very hard to find.
Okay, yeah, it should work pretty well with oil as well. I've never tried it before, but yeah, Michelle is correct. I really struggled to find it. I just couldn't find it anywhere.
So, Chef Dan, if people want to employ you to come work in their homes, how do they get hold of you?
So they can go to my Instagram page. I'm there at Bar Chef Dan, or you can visit my website.
BY Chef Dan,
or you can visit my website, www.bychefdan.com, and all of my contact information is there. Give me a call, and yeah, I'm just, my thing is that I love cooking. I love food. I have such an amazing passion for it, and I just want to share it with everyone possible.
What's your favorite thing to cook?
I thought this question might come up. My favorite food in the entire world to cook and to eat is pizza, without a doubt.
Pizza? You're a chef.
100%. No, I at one stage went down the pizza rabbit hole, and it's more like a Mariana's Trench, if I can say. Pizza has got such a rich history. It's got so many different facets to it. I read about this pizza restaurant in New York where the chef wouldn't serve tap water with his pizza because he didn't want to ruin the flavor of his own pizza with the tap water, because apparently New York tap water doesn't taste so great.
I can attest to that. Yeah. It's a true story. But tell us, what do you put on your pizza?
My favorite pizza is just the plain old margherita, tomato sauce, and cheese, maybe a little bit of fresh basil on top of that. But, and I don't know if my friend Adam is watching, but my very, very close childhood friend Adam, I taught him when we were kids to have pineapple on pizza. And maybe I'll get roasted for saying that, because I know some people are very much against that. But I love
your credibility is gone out of the window. But Dan, I see Monica's given me a great idea of what to do, but it involves crushing my nuts, which doesn't seem like a fantastic idea. But one last question. You mentioned that you did a take on gefilte fish. We've had a request for a gefilte fish recipe. Are you willing to share one when we send out the recipes to everyone who's registered for tonight?
Yes, of course. Of course. I can share both.
I have the gefilte manifesto.
Oh, wow.
That's a whole book. That book. A whole book dedicated to gefilte fish. But if you're prepared to share yours, Dan, with our audience as well, I think that'd be very grateful.
Without a doubt, Howard.
Amazing. So Dina, that brings us to the end of our pre-Pesach cooking show. And I think it probably is just requiring of all of us to wish everyone who's watching us an amazing and hopefully peaceful and uplifting Pesach this year.
Absolutely. And Chag Sameach to everyone. As I actually said in the blurb when it went out originally, is that Jews have always found comfort in food. And I think all the food we saw tonight was beyond outstanding and will give us all comfort, and hopefully will be shared across the globe with the whole nation, and we'll all hopefully see peace in our time very shortly. And
and freedom. Hey, this everyone. Is the festival of freedom.
And freedom.
Can Absolutely. I unmute myself briefly?
Absolutely, Melissa.
Hello, gorgeous. Okay, awesome. So I just wanted to give you a little flick around, if I can figure out how to do this on Zoom. Flick the camera around. So these are the roasted veggies that came out that like the Italian style. You see, they're just like brown and caramelized and golden. So that could go down with couscous or anything, or quinoa. And these are going in one layer thick. Again, what I was trying to explain to you, one layer thick. And then I started a stock here. But the most important thing I wanted to say before I jump off is 8 years ago, I wrote this cookbook. My first cookbook, it was a Passover cookbook before my mother passed, and it had most of her amazing recipes in it. And I've gifted this book over the last 8 years many times. So if you guys head to my website, and when you find my Passover cookbook, you put in the code Mashiach Now, you can have the entire book for free.
So Melissa, we're going to include that when we send it out, the code to get the entire cookbook for free to anyone who's registered for tonight. We'll put that out as well.
Nashan, bless you. And I think one of you need to run for president. And that's my last bit.
Taksamak, everyone. We'll see you on the 5th of May, where we've got an amazing webinar with Gershon Baskin, the guy who started the negotiations for Gilad Shalit's release. We're going to be talking about his story. We're going to talk about hostage negotiations. And we're going to be talking about whether there are any regrets, because one of the people who was released with Gilad Shalit was Yahya Sinwar, who's been the person responsible for the Al-Aqsa flood attack invasion of Israel that left 1,200 people dead in its wake and 253 people hostages. So we'll see you again after Pesach. Chag Sameach, everyone. Chag Sameach, Dina.
Chag Sameach. Happy cooking to everyone.
Ciao. Bye.